A very good morning, everyone, and welcome to this final virtual seminar in our series on defined benefit, or DB, pensions and advice. Thank you once again for registering for this event. We do hope that you and all those close to you are staying well. Thanks to everyone who's seen one or more of our three sessions we've done so far during May. If you missed last week's session, a link was attached to the emailed reminders you would have received yesterday from my colleague Emma Godfrey. And I think Emma is also putting links for all three of our previous sessions into the chat stream for this meeting, if you can see that in Microsoft Teams. And if for any reason you haven't been able to access them, please do reach out to one of us and we can send you the links directly. My name is Peter Lovegrove, and my colleague Rebecca Prestage and I work in Grant Thornton's regulatory advisory practice. Good morning once again, Rebecca. How are you today?
Good morning, Peter. Morning, everyone. I'm very well, thank you. You?
Yes, I'm fine, thank you. Rebecca and I are both pension transfer specialists. And our team has done a lot of work over the past couple of years with firms and other industry parties on various aspects of DB pensions and advice. And as we're all still in lockdown for the time being, we wanted to continue sharing some observations and insights with you. My usual couple of logistical and housekeeping points, if you'll bear with me. First of all, this is a virtual event and it's being recorded. We will distribute it to all those who registered as soon as we can afterwards. And as usual, we do apologise in advance for any unexpected interruptions. We're recording this from our homes, and if there are disruptions, be they technological or noises off, please do forgive us. We'll do our best to minimise that, and thank you for your understanding. Before we get stuck into our final session today, let's just briefly recap what we've covered across these four sessions. So back on the 6th of May, Rebecca and I talked about the current state of the DB pension advice market, FCA expectations, and the profound impact that the COVID-19 crisis is having and will continue to have. And then 2 weeks ago, we talked about what we call the groundwork for good advice. So we covered triage, fact-finding, charges and disclosure. Last week, we delved into some good practice that we've seen around developing advised solutions that genuinely meet a client's true needs, including suitability reports. And today, we're going to be talking about an advice process and the controls and governance arrangements that we think sit well around that advice process. For those of you who've seen these sessions before, the format is pretty straightforward. Rebecca and I will have a conversation to explore the topic, but we would really like you to participate. If there are any questions or observations you'd like to make, please do submit them via the chat function, and we'll do our very best to address them either during or at the end of the session. We've had lots of interesting questions as part of these sessions so far. We're trying to share answers in written format afterwards, and we'll continue to do that. We have had some questions submitted for this one today in advance as well. So as I say, we'll try and address those. A bit like last week, today's topic is another quite meaty one, and it will necessarily involve revisiting some of the issues we've discussed earlier in the series, albeit in the context of a controls environment. We'll do our best to stick to the time. Please stick with us if you can, but obviously go if you must, and please do forgive us if we go slightly over the 45 minutes. So Rebecca, what's on the agenda today?
Oh, thank you, Peter. So I think today we're going to step back from the details of the actual transfer advice itself to consider more about the actual process and what we think works well by way of controls and governance. Outcomes for customers can be undermined if an advice process is not well controlled, if advisors are not very well trained in using it, and if proposed advice solutions are not rigorously checked. We'll explore how to do this well, we hope, and we're going to be looking at things like what we consider to be the key components of a successful advice process, and the checks and controls that can be in place at each stage. The wider governance considerations and arrangements that can cover the process, and the kind of oversight and management information that FCA expects. As this is the last in our series, I think we'll also hopefully circle back to our state of the DB pensions advice market conversation from the first session. I think a month feels like quite a long time now. And yep. I think it's probably worth revisiting some of the observations that we made on the 6th of May. So I think if we sort of kick off with those sort of things in mind, Peter.
So Sounds good. Yep. Okay. So let's start with sort of the mechanics of the advice process then. So we've designed and reviewed quite a few advice processes. What do you think are the most fundamental considerations, perhaps at a sort of a business model level to start with?
So it's worth pointing out from the very start that the FCA expectations of the nature and extent of a firm's controls environment is proportionate to its size, scale, complexity, and perceived risks that it poses to good customer outcomes. Put simply, the expectations are much higher for a national network than a one-person IFA firm by virtue of their respective profiles and number of customers. But we'll discuss a bit more about that in detail a bit later. So I think, as you said, one of the key things to consider before the design stage is what your firm's business model is and how you intend to operate. For example, whether you'll be providing a restricted or independent advice service, what the pros and cons are for your particular business, and what sort of model better suits you. The next thing is to consider is which advisors in your firm will be providing this specialised service. Will you have a relatively small PTS team to whom referrals are made from other advisors? Or will every advisor in your firm be trained to offer this advice? Will you accept referrals from other advisory firms? I think depending on your model, you'll need to ensure that you've got clear lines of demarcation so that everybody understands their own individual roles and responsibilities, and to ensure that no one is straying beyond the bounds of their regulatory sort of permission or status. And I think once designed, the key thing then is to make sure that the process is fully documented with sort of guidance documents that sets out all the relevant processes and procedures for your advisors. You'll need to ensure that you've got all the relevant disclosure documents to support the delivery of advice, as well as, obviously, appropriate systems and controls around the advice proposition itself. I think, Peter, you're going to talk about that in a bit more detail later. You also need to consider your approach and devise policies to address certain, you know, situations that perhaps might not be as common. But you'll need to have things in place to deal with sort of vulnerable customers, how you'll give advice to absent customers, remote type advice to people can't get face to face, how you intend to deal with spouse. You know, some firms will only give advice if the spouse is present. Mm-hmm. Some might be able to sort of deal with the spouse or with disclaimer or waiver letters. Individuals who are either divorced or going through a divorce, how you intend to sort of deal with those and what other caveats you might need to put in place. Non-UK residents, so people living abroad or about to emigrate, you'll need policies in place for those, as well as your approach to perhaps insistent customers. Mm-hmm. So onto the advice process itself, it's very important that when designing an advice process that firms think about the potential risks its process may pose to its customers, both in terms of the quality and the type of the actual advice provided, but as well as the advice process itself. Firms should be mindful of this throughout all of the individual steps within the process. It's a case really of undertaking a conduct risk assessment to identify the potential risks at each stage of the process, and where possible, consider ways to mitigate those. And I think we think it's always worth considering a pilot launch of any new process first, to build in time to test all elements of the process, make relevant adaptations, changes, additions to the process. And I think importantly, you'll also need to incorporate a training programme to deliver all aspects of the advice process. And I think that training should include elements of theory as well as practice, with sort of relevant and appropriate sign-off procedures.
Okay, interesting. And I think very, very good advice. So you talked about different stages there. So let's delve a bit deeper now into the various components of an advice process and the checks and controls that we think work well at each stage. So let's perhaps start with triage. What should firms be considering as controls around triage?
So we believe that a triage stage is a very important first or pre-stage to a DB pension advice process. This is a stage at which you'll provide the customer with enough information about safeguarded and flexible pension benefits, details around what an advice process will involve, and to help the customer to decide whether to take advice in the first place on their DB assets. So whilst this is a stage that isn't something that firms need to do, we think it's a very helpful educational piece to inform and empower the customer. I mentioned earlier about identifying risks of the process to the customer and potential ways to mitigate these where possible. Done well, a triage stage can prevent customers from incurring significant risks and incurring costs for advice that is perhaps unnecessary or inappropriate. And by extension, it also will protect the firm from the risk associated with giving advice to somebody who doesn't really need it or for whom the outcome could potentially be unsuitable. If you do adopt the triage assessment, you should ensure that you can point to evidence that some prospective customers to whom you interacted with don't make it as far as the advice process itself. So if the FCA come knocking, that you can document, you know, that some people didn't proceed. The FCA does recognise the benefits of triage, I think. But talking about risks, you know, beware about inadvertently crossing the advice boundary. Whilst if done well, triage can be helpful and informative to the customer, it does come with an element of risk that firms need to guard against. Triage can and should be strictly non-advised and advertised as such to the customer, be factual and neutral, that's crucial, and just present a generic balanced view of the potential advantages and disadvantages. I think it's also very important to set out at this stage what your stance is as a firm to insistent customers. So if somebody isn't necessarily going to get the answer that they want and you won't facilitate them transferring anyway, then I think that needs to be set out as well. But I think, you know, any reference, however sort of seemingly innocuous, to how a customer's personal circumstances may influence the advice is likely to constitute a personal recommendation. So firms need to be careful about that. Any guidance steering a customer sort of towards or away from a transfer, however well-intentioned or informal, is likely to constitute a personal recommendation. So I think it's helpful for firms' own risk management to ensure that whether or not to proceed with advice is the customer's own decision and to document this. It's probably also helpful at this stage to find out if a customer is in possession of a CETV, because that will sort of perhaps, you know, inform how you proceed with a customer. I mean, we know from experience customers naturally want to discuss their own personal situations, sometimes in great detail. So it can take a fair degree of skill to remain neutral and keep the conversation generic, which is why we think the triage stage should form an essential part of the training programme, where advisors are given an opportunity to sort of practice these difficult types of conversation.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, so ideally firms would have controls to check the extent to which all the things you just mentioned are actually happening sort of on the ground.
Yeah.
Yeah, so okay, so moving on from triage then to disclosure and then fact finding. What considerations or controls do you think firms should be mindful of here?
So the next stage of what we would call the advice process proper is where you'd set out obviously your terms of business and all the other disclosure requirements. I think you'll talk a little bit more about those. This is where you should be explaining to the customer what they'll pay for the advice and at what stage, what service they should get in return. And it's important that sort of, you know, the accompanying materials support the process. It's also important at this stage to outline the potential timeframes associated with the advice, because there will be risk to the customer and ultimately the firm if advice ends up being sort of based on expired transfer values. And I think arguably, you know, the information gathering stage is the most important step of the process, as it will underpin the entire process and ultimately the quality of the advice provided. The information gathered will allow you to provide personalised advice based on a customer's true needs. We find some firms might have a separate DB advice questionnaire. Some have a specific sort of attitude to transfer risk questionnaire, which they use to establish how a customer feels about safeguarded benefits, how they feel about secure income versus, you know, pension assets in an environment that perhaps might be subject to investment risk. I think either method is fine, so long as advisors are aware of the nuanced nature of this type of advice and aware of the sort of different or additional information that is required to give this type of advice well. I think it's crucial that this stage isn't rushed and that it's not led or directed by the customer. Advisors aren't there to take orders. They're there to sort of provide sound, high quality financial advice. And again, this requires a great deal of skill to probe and challenge customers' goals, objectives, preconceived ideas, feelings that they may have about their retirement. And again, it's crucial that this stage forms a large part of any training programme, where advisors are given an opportunity to really practice extensively and comprehensively with their peers. And I think the most important thing really about this stage is that advisors are prepared and able to cut short the process if they feel that a customer is not forthcoming with the required information or details. I think this came up as a question from one of the participants a couple of weeks ago. COBS 9.2 clearly states that a firm must have all the necessary information to be able to provide a personal recommendation. We see time and time examples of advice being given with very scant personal information, goals, objectives, sometimes even information about the seeding scheme. And I think it's about understanding the risks associated with giving this advice without the necessary information is key for advisors to understand. Sometimes one crucial piece of information can flip a recommendation to being a transfer or to being a remain. So I think sort of understanding all about that is important. And I think it's very important that the process allows for more than one fact-finding meeting if necessary. It's perfectly feasible to conduct further meetings or even sort of have meetings or additional questions over the telephone. But, you know, having all the information, I think, is key.
Yeah, you're right. You're certainly right about we see instances time and again of a sort of what like very incomplete fact finds. Yeah. And the trouble there is not necessarily that the advice is wrong, but the advisor can't prove that it's right, which to a large extent amounts to the same thing. Yeah, so having controls around that and the checks that you do to check that you've got enough information to support the advice is really important.
Yep.
Great.
Yep.
Okay, so after fact finding, the next stage is to undertake appropriate pension transfer analysis.
Yeah.
And so, as you were saying, combined with the fact finding, this is arguably the most important and the riskiest part of the process, both for the customers and for the advisor. So what practices, controls, and checks can firms consider using here, do you think?
So we find here that, you know, having a step in the process that allows for contact with the scheme to obtain necessary scheme details is crucial. Customers may well have a benefit statement, but there could still be quite a lot of additional information that you as an advisor will need. So things like early retirement factors, partial transfer options, death benefits or definitions of dependents. And we've seen put to good use, you know, a support or administrative staff function in some organisations that get involved in this part of the process. Where they've got sort of systems in place to provide prompters and chasers for all of this information. I think the use of templated letters and scheme request forms are also quite useful to have here. And it's making sure that there's time in the process to gather all of that. I think once in possession of all of the facts, the analysis is the step in the process that will ultimately drive the advice that's provided. So as you'd expect, any flaws in the process at this stage can have a huge impact on the advice that's provided and can expose the customer to greater risks of poor outcomes. This again is where relevant training is needed to ensure all advisors understand how to interrogate seeding scheme data. You know, perhaps there are schemes with sort of, you know, different service dates and things like that, and to be able to conduct appropriate analysis. It may be as a firm that you choose to employ the use of a third party provider or a pension analysis provider to provide TVC or the old TVAS type documents, which is absolutely fine. And as a firm, you'll need to undertake the relevant third party due diligence and have contracts in place that detail all of the roles and responsibilities of both parties, as well as comprehensive SLAs. We see some firms that have like a central analysis or power planning type function that will conduct all of the necessary analysis. And again, this is for firms to decide upon and will be determined by the size and scale of their operation and risk appetite. We also see some firms having QA checks or peer review checks at the analysis stage to give a four eyes approach to both sort of data input and data output. The use of cash flow modelling tools can be used at this stage. And again, it's useful to introduce a peer review of any sort of cash flow or TVC reports that you might be putting together as an advisor to give to your client. And I think peer review checklists are a useful sort of aid memoir at this stage. I mean, I think last week we talked about, you know, it could be a good idea to have another client meeting at this stage to bring to life conceptual conversations that you've had around transfer risk. And I think this is, you know, a good step to have in your process. And it's also a good opportunity to gauge how the customer really feels about giving up guarantees. You can have more quantified discussions around the potential trade-offs. So having that sort of extra meeting is quite useful. The extra conversation can help sort of mitigate the risk of a customer making an incorrect or irreversible decision. It can never be too rushed. However, I think you need to be very careful when having this meeting that you're not backfilling objectives in order to potentially justify transfer. So sometimes we think it's a good idea to perhaps preserve the integrity of the initial fact find and update details of this conversation in, a supplementary fact find type document. And I think once you've conducted all your analysis and you've presented all of the facts to the customer and you've had all your trade-off conversations, you'll then be in a position to put together your suitability report. And I think, Peter, you discussed last week some top tips when pulling this together with regard to content. But from a process point of view, I think this is where you need to consider whether or not, as a firm, you'll be adopting a templated approach or a free format approach. We think either can work, and we've seen good and poor examples of both. A templated report can work very well because, all of the relevant disclosure points should be there and it's less likely that you'll miss key information. However, we do often see templated or generic objectives and generic rationale or justification for advice usually to transfer in these sorts of suitability reports. We've seen some firms where all of the suitability reports are pretty much identical, just with a different name and a different CETV. And I think that's an example of where templated reports just do not work. However, where there's a functionality to have a really good degree of personalization and free format text, templated reports can work well. And I think, Peter, as you mentioned last week, it's the use of the customer's own words that's vital here. Equally, a suitability report that's not templated can work well. And that will usually have, we find, lots of personalised information. But from a risk perspective, there's obviously a higher chance that key information can be left out. And it will really depend on the size of your organisation, the number and the degree of experience of your advisors, as well as the sort of level of autonomy that you grant your advisors. This is also the step in the process where you decide whether or not you'll be having advice checks. Well, probably more like the nature of the advice checks, so whether they'll be pre-sale, post-sale, both, or a combination of both. We've seen many large firms adopting sort of pre- and post-sale checks from a sales quality perspective, or some smaller firms adopting what we call like a peer review check. So they have another colleague, PTS, that will review their suitability reports before it's given to the client. The approach that you adopt will be driven, again, largely by the number of advisors that you have, their level of experience in giving this type of advice, and your risk appetite of your firm. I think then, following sort of pre-sale checks, you'll be presenting your advice to your customer. And after this stage, many firms will adopt a post-sale check, which I know you're going to talk about in a bit more detail, which is obviously where all of the advice in its entirety is sort of checked prior to implementation of any solutions. And I think these checkpoints are valuable steps in the process and could potentially sort of spot errors or omissions and hopefully mitigate the risk of a poor outcome. I think it's important as well that you also need to be considering or have already considered your approach to insistent clients. Will you, as a firm, facilitate a transfer for a client who wishes to go against advice, for example, if they want to act on an insistent basis? If you do choose to assist your clients in this way, then you'll need to ensure that you've fully thought through and documented your insistent advice process, incorporating all of the relevant COBS rules, which will obviously include the provision of, a further report to the client setting out their options and risks of going against the recommended course of action. So if you are using sort of templated reports, then you need to have additional sort of templates to cater for that scenario. And obviously, if you decide not to facilitate insistent customers to transfer, then you must make sure that that's fully explained at the outset of the process, so they haven't got to this stage and then perhaps need to start the cycle again with another advisor. And it's obviously at this stage as well that you'll need to be considering your approach to the provision of an ongoing advice service, particularly where clients have got investments to manage.
Great, thank you. Very comprehensive, some really good ideas in there. You've mentioned a few times the importance of training and the importance of a comprehensive and appropriate training plan to ensure all advisors are equipped to successfully and compliantly deliver this pretty complicated advice. So what have we seen work well in terms of approaches to training?
So firstly, I think depending on the size of your organisation and the referral process that you have in place, you need to identify who in your organisation needs training and needs what type of training. So it could be that an element of training is also needed to be delivered to support or ancillary staff, particularly those that are involved in sort of triage or referral type conversations. The size and type of your organisation will also determine the type and extent of your sign-off procedures. So you'll need to have, you know, the procedures in place to know which advisors will get sort of through the training programme. We think training should include an element of theory. So, you know, perhaps sort of objective tested assessments, multiple choice, as well as sort of practical subjective tested assessments. We would highly recommend training around the different interactions with the customer. So, for example, a series of role plays that give the advisor the opportunity to practice certain questioning techniques around fact finding and establishing attitude to transfer risk. You know, asking how a customer feels about certain aspects of guaranteed and secured income. And I think it's practicing those sort of challenging and probing conversations with the customer to overcome objections, to really understand the goals, understand where goals and objectives might be unrealistic, and be able to sort of have those honest conversations to point those out to the customer. Training then should also incorporate an element of practice around analysis stage. So conducting the APTA and TVC, understanding the facts and figures and being able to explain these in a meaningful way to the customer. Again, dealing with sort of objections and having those trade-off conversations. You know, having the experience to do this will really help. And then I think really, like, you know, advisors should be able to practice report writing and having these peer reviewed and assessed during the sign-off programme. And then, you know, once everybody's signed off and on the road and given this advice, your training programme should include an element of annual assessment. So, for example, sort of an annual CPD type test. It's certainly possible to make use of the available industry type training or CPD, which is out there, often usually provided for and a requirement of professional bodies. Although an annual assessment should also include an element of firm specific processes and procedures. And then I think sort of depending on the type and frequency of the QA oversight you have whilst advisors are out on the road, you should have the ability to pull advisors off the road if they're not sort of meeting or adhering to your firm's own sort of quality standards. So, So that's sort of, I think, a bit of a tour through the different steps. And I think sort of now we've sort of considered some good design features and sort of where controls might be embedded within the process. It's probably worth thinking a bit more about governance and oversight. Peter, what do you think works well and what would you think the FCA would expect to see?
Yeah, okay. So perhaps a good place to start is to reiterate the importance of a point that you made earlier, Rebecca, which is that FCA's expectations are, or certainly should be, proportionate to the size and the scale and the reach and the complexity of your firm. And any inherent risks that its business model poses to good customer outcomes. I think if you're a relatively small firm, then being able to demonstrate the existence and crucially the effectiveness of the controls at each stage of the process of the type that you were describing earlier, that's likely, I think, to take you quite a long way to meeting FCA expectations. And perhaps arguably the biggest danger in this respect for smaller firms is that they allow themselves to exist indefinitely in a sort of an isolated bubble with no or very little exposure to independent scrutiny. So you might be very happy with your advice, and indeed you may be very justified in being happy with your advice, but independent outside validation, even if it's only a very small sample every now and again, is a good idea. Sometimes we see firms who are, you know, entrenched in this bubble, and they can't prove they're keeping up to date, and the lack of independent scrutiny. So I think that's important. But of course, the larger you get and the more advice you give to more customers, regulatory expectations are going to increase. And at a certain point, the FCA will expect you to have some kind of, you know, second line oversight function, which looks at the advice process and its outputs. and at a highest level, that function should include reviewing the extent to which the process that you've been describing is actually followed correctly and consistently, and that the controls that you've suggested are taking place and that they are recorded. And perhaps even more importantly than that, the second line function should be looking at whether the controls are meaningful and effective. Are they working in practice as they are intended to work? Are they toothy? Also, you'd expect a second line to be considering, importantly, the reviews and the peer reviews of advice that take place in the first line, whether that's at the analysis stage or the actual recommendation and advice stage. And the second line needs to ask itself, are those controls working? Are they spotting errors and omissions? Are they spotting possible unsuitable advice instances and picking them up and correcting them? So that's really important. Rebecca, you talked earlier about inherent features of a business model and a firm's activities. And the FCA expects, I think, an oversight function to understand that and to understand how a firm's activities and business model could at least in potentially drive behaviour which is poor or which presents obstacles to good outcomes, and of course to have effective controls to address them. So it might be worth just picking out a few of those sort of business model type features. Firstly, there's the obvious one, which is the charging structure. We talked a couple of weeks ago about the sort of three very broad types of charging structure associated with DB advice. It's worth reiterating, as we said, that as things stand, firms are permitted absolutely to charge for DB pension advice on a contingent basis at the moment anyway. In other words, they only receive payment in the event of DB assets actually leaving a scheme. The FCA has said that it believes that suitable advice can be given in this way, but given the FCA's concern that there certainly seems to be a link, they would say, between contingent charging and poor advice to transfer, as we know, the FCA is consulting on banning it, other than for a small number of prescribed circumstances. And we do think the firms can expect contingent charging to be banned in due course. And I think also in any event, we think that a non-contingent charging model does make it easier for advisors to demonstrate that there are no, undesirable motives sitting behind any advice that's given. I think there's something else there as well, which to me is really important. I think as an advisor, you're not really selling a transaction, you're selling your expertise and your time. Advisors, I think, sometimes underestimate the value of the service they actually provide, because if this is done well, what you're doing is nothing less than giving somebody financial peace of mind for the rest of their life. So that's valuable. I think that's true even if, having assessed the complete universe of a customer's finances, you don't make any changes at all. You're still giving them that peace of mind that they're going to be okay for the rest of their lives. That's very valuable. Don't underestimate it. Related, of course, to a firm's charging structure is how individual advisors are paid. And I think a good rule of thumb is that the greater the extent to which an advisor's remuneration is linked to transfers or sales volumes, the greater the degree of likely regulatory interest, and therefore the greater the intensity of the controls that are needed to manage that risk. Everyone will be aware, I'm sure, that the FCA is far more comfortable in principle with incentives and bonuses which are linked to quality and outcomes rather than to volume and productivity. So I think firms need to think a lot about on what basis they incentivize and reward their advisors, and can evidence that that's going on. We talked as well a couple of weeks ago about the prospect of ongoing charges, so post-initial advice charges, potentially for a number of years into the future, represents a conduct risk for advisors to manage, and we think that it does. There's nothing wrong at all in principle with providing ongoing advice, quite the reverse. Ongoing advice will be very, very beneficial for many people. But it is, we think, incumbent on the advisor to be able to demonstrate that the individual customer has a genuine need for that ongoing advice and that they will derive genuine value from it. And that means that you have a controls environment in place which assesses when ongoing advice is given to people and asks those questions. I remember also that CP 1925, we discussed this a couple of weeks ago, proposes that firms must allow customers to opt out of ongoing advice at any time. You've touched on referrals from other advisors, Rebecca, earlier today, as we have previously in this series. So if you're a pension transfer specialist, by all means, accept referrals from elsewhere. either within or beyond your own firm, but do make sure that you're applying the same standards, particularly to fact finding and information gathering, that you would expect of yourself, and there are controls there to check that actually happens. Also, I think this is the case for some firms and groups, but not for others, obviously. But managing potential conflicts of interest is a consideration for firms that are part of a so-called vertically integrated group. And we see problems here every now and again. So, for example, if you work for a group entity which is involved in giving initial DB pension advice, you may feel incentivized either explicitly or implicitly to refer customers to other entities within your group, for example, for a product or indeed for ongoing advice or other services. And we have seen firms get into trouble with regulators when they can't demonstrate that the potential conflicts of interest that could pose are being well managed. So we think that a second line monitoring function should have a program of activities and management information, MI, that looks at all of these issues to whatever extent is necessary and appropriate for an individual firm. It's perhaps worth just cantering through a few examples of good MI that we've seen on our travels. So we've seen firms collect MI around the balance of advice given between remaining and transferring. Yeah. That's helpful. But I think also it's particularly helpful is where that's set against some sort of expected benchmark. So it can be helpful for an individual firm, given its customer base, its approach, to have a sort of a default or an expected level of transfer out and remain recommendations, and to track the extent to which your advice actually stays close to that benchmark. Of course, there may be very good reasons why it deviates, but it's a good means of spotting the potential for poor customer outcomes. And similarly, we've seen other things work well around customers who are advised to take ongoing advice or not, again around the same sort of benchmark idea. Clearly a second line function needs to check the level of pre and post advice checks that you described earlier. So are they happening, and is the amount and proportion happening in the way which you as a firm have prescribed? And of course, as we mentioned earlier, the results of those checks are very, very important. Now, the SEA, I think, accepts that advice will not be perfect every time, to the extent, in fact, that a flawless 100% pass rate for all your pre and all your post checks, it might actually generate SEA interest and challenge in a way that a 90-95% pass rate may not do, because it may lead the SEA to question how robust really is that checking. You talked about sort of risk-based monitoring for advisors. Yeah, so it's helpful perhaps, depending on your firm and the makeup of your advisors, to subject advisors to different levels of advice checking, either frequency or intensity, depending on their experience, their time with the firm, their qualifications, and the level of their past performance with their advice checks. It's helpful to understand the extent to which the capabilities that your procedures have to penalise advisors or indeed other staff for breaches of advice quality and policies are actually exercised in practice. Again, it's almost helpful. Obviously, you shouldn't artificially manufacture anything, of course not, but it's almost helpful with regulatory interactions to be able to show that you A, have the capacity to take action against advisors, and indeed B, you have done so where it was warranted. Other useful MI, of course, are complaint volumes and the result of complaint investigations. And I think it's also helpful for MI to track trends. But all these things we've been talking about, to have trend analysis, which tells a story over time. The SEA is comforted to know that firms are doing that kind of thing. And obviously, the best defence you have as a firm is to be able to prove that the advice you give and the customer outcomes you provide is good and consistently good. Because if that's the case, and if that's independently verified somehow, then that shows that whatever you're doing is working and your controls environment is effective. We focus so far on sort of the advice itself and on those who provide it or support it, but there are plenty of other things to consider. Rebecca, you've mentioned the need for good organisational and administrative capabilities. You could be the most brilliant pension transfer specialist ever, but if your firm's infrastructure can't effectively flag you've received some important information, or that there are things missing from that information, then your ability to give good advice is heavily compromised. And of course, none of these activities and items of MI mean as much as they should unless they're actually well used by those who receive them and who see them. And again, this is an area where expectations will increase as organisations increase in size and reach and customer numbers. The FCA expects senior decision makers and the holders of all the relevant functions within the senior managers and certification regime to know what they need to know to manage risks. So firms must continuously challenge themselves. Are the senior people and the committees, for firms that are large enough, in receipt of clear, timely and accurate information that gives an unvarnished view of what the business is really doing? And firms must be able to demonstrate that those in charge have got sufficient expertise and experience and that they're sufficiently engaged. You know, can you prove that you're reviewing and appropriately challenging the MI and the reports that are sent up to the more senior decision makers and committees in a firm? And again, I think finally, when a firm gets large enough, yes, they would expect a third line, an internal audit oversight function to be challenging what both the lines underneath it are doing, and indeed perhaps getting independent outside assurance that processes and controls are robust and do consistently generate suitable advice. Mm. There we go, a few thoughts there.
Brilliant, thank you, Peter. Lots and lots of really good stuff there. So I think that actually completes our four-week tour of the considerations and components that we believe are key to providing suitable advice and being able to demonstrate this. So we hope everybody's found that useful. But I think what we thought would be useful to do at the end is sort of circling back to the beginning, to some of the market-wide issues that we discussed during the first session, including, of course, sort of the effects of the COVID crisis. You know, I think a lot's happened in the last month. Are you able, Peter, maybe just sort of remind us of some of the points we picked out and whether stuff has sort of changed or moved on since then?
Yeah, OK, good question. We'll try and get through this as quickly as we can. I'm conscious of time. Well, I mean, we said, didn't we, that even before the COVID-19 crisis, there were quite strong indications that the market for DB pensions advice, while still significant, has been slowing and could well slow further. We quoted some statistics indicating that whilst there was quite a big increase after the pension freedoms in 2015, transfer activity in 2019 was slowing. And we sort of diagnosed that as due to a combination of all this FCA scrutiny we've been talking about, the proposed changes, further changes in CP 1925, the FOS compensation limit going up, and difficulties that some firms are experiencing around PI cover. And then specifically because of the COVID-19 crisis, we noted things like lower transfer values, market volatility, customer and advisor nervousness around making very big decisions. And we sort of said we could reasonably guesstimate that between 15, 20, 25% of schemes were choosing to suspend transfer values. A month is a long time, as you say. I think some things are similar now. But could some things be changing? Well, I think it's still true that all those factors that are deeper than COVID-19 creating a potential contraction in the DB advice market remain. And at the moment, we need to be especially concerned, I think, as an industry about consumers maybe facing job losses, reduced income, seeing their pension schemes, including their DB assets, as a shorter term solution to making ends meet in these challenging times. Balancing current and future requirements whilst overcoming the now bias, if you like, in these uncertain times is going to be arguably more difficult than ever. You would hope, though, that in this uncertainty, consumers would sort of consider the value of the safeguards provided by DB benefits more than ever, and that they're encouraged to do so by anybody giving them advice. We know there's a lot of financial crime going on at the moment, unfortunately, as well. So beware of scams. A crisis, unfortunately, generates opportunities for fraudsters. I think we can also note that there was some interesting research in mid-May. This is from an advisory firm called ISIO. It surveyed 380 trustees and found that 27% of them had suspended cash equivalent transfer value quotations. Largely because due to falling markets, it's very difficult for them to accurately value the underlying assets in the scheme. I think that's definitely a factor at the moment. It also seems that the number of active DB advisors is falling. So according to Aegon and Next Wealth's report, Retirement Advice in the UK, which was published in the middle of May, 41% of all advice firms still worked in the DB transfer advice market in September last year. That was down from 56% the year before. So fewer advisors are choosing to be active in this market. However, there may be some indications that DB schemes that sort of informally paused the issue of transfer value quotations are starting up again. We know that TPR, pension regulator, introduced some emergency measures at the end of March to allow DB schemes to suspend transfer value quotations for 3 months. Some schemes decided to do that straight away. Others decided to sort of pause issuing of quotations. It seems that there's been a significant drop in the request for quotes. But within that, the proportion of those who completed transfer having had a quote may well be quite similar. So that suggests that those who are quite motivated or for whom a transfer is a good idea are not being discouraged. There are also reports that schemes that suspended transfer value quotes at the start of the lockdown are reviewing that decision and deciding to start quoting again, albeit with some caution. And we think that schemes need to monitor their funding levels amid this high volatility and negotiate this tricky challenge that emerges, which is, you know, the reliably valuing the assets in the scheme and therefore the accuracy of transfer values. I think it's likely that trustees are only intending to maintain suspensions of transfers whilst they assess their options in this respect. You know, they need time to consider whether the assumptions that they make to calculate transfer values at the moment remain appropriate. Further observations on the pensions regulator. So yeah, they issued guidance at the end of March around trustees choosing to delay new transfer requests can do so for up to 3 months. I think TPR is bound to come under pressure to review, amend or update in some way that guidance as this crisis continues. And so only yesterday I spotted a blog by TPR's chief executive, Charles Council. He's warning that the trustees should inform the FCA if they come across any unusual or concerning patterns when doing transfers. For example, spikes in activity or the same advisor popping up across a range of different member requests. So that's an interesting regulatory nudge on trustees to do things other than simply administering schemes. You know, should they be spotting possible patterns or possible instances of systemic, you know, sort of unsuitable behaviour?
Yeah.
Finally, back to the FCA. I'm sure many people have spotted their catchily titled Regulatory Initiatives Grid, which was published on the 7th of May. And it's worth noting that they've announced their intention to publish between July and September this year data on this wide-ranging, industry-wide thematic review of DB advice that they've been doing and data on the size and the value of this market. So watch out for that if you didn't spot that.
Brilliant. Thank you, Peter. I think that was a good to sort of recap on that. I am very conscious of time. We're opening the floor to questions. We've had a couple come through, so I might just sort of condense a couple. There's a first question around whether or not you can get sort of CPD for this, proof of participation. So I think if you email, I think Layla, then we can confirm attendance for those people. There's been a couple of questions around sort of the outsourcing of, you know, whether or not, you know, it's okay to sort of outsource certain elements. And I think, you know, obviously we touched on that and we obviously think that's okay as long as you've got sort of certain, you know, controls in place and you do your due diligence. There was one question around sort of more specific issues such as sort of the intended retirement age subsequently moving after customer discussions. Such that a customer does not get a financial comparison at their intended retirement date because they've already had the sort of a TVAS or TVC provided by their outsourced third party. And I think what our thoughts are on that is, you know, advice ultimately needs to be based upon, you know, the right numbers and the right figures. I think this is where it's crucial to do really comprehensive fact finding at the beginning to make sure you are discussing the different scenarios. You know, and there's certainly nothing wrong with getting figures to different retirement ages, you know, at outset. This is why this is a long and lengthy process in the first place, and does take time. So I think ultimately, you know, you need to be trying to sort of get the figures that are useful for the client. And then there's one other question, Peter, which I think I'll ask you. The wisdom or otherwise of including your compliance team sort of in a medium sized firm to authorise pre point of sale and then having the same people being tasked with compliance monitoring of the same activity. What are your brief thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think in two words, potentially problematic. I think, you know, there's an inherent problem, certainly as far as the FCA is concerned, with those involved materially in the construction or the sign-off of advice also being materially involved in its checking. You know, that seems to me to be an insufficient level of demarcation. Now, I appreciate that there are practical challenges sometimes, particularly as firms get smaller. But I think perhaps a better way of doing it is to have some checking or some peer reviewing going on inside what the FCA would regard as a first line, and then a second line overseeing the effectiveness of that activity, rather than, you know, the approving the initial advice itself. I think that might work better.
Great. Right. So I think that we're draw to a close there, I think. Thank you so much to everyone who's joined us today. Apologies that we've run over slightly. We've hoped that you found the whole series and the presentations and the Q&As helpful. I think, as we mentioned earlier, the recordings will be distributed after this. Our contact details, as ever, are still up on the screen. It does remain our intention, hopefully, to organise a seminar or a workshop in real life, as it were, in our London offices, if we're able to. But in the meantime, thank you for joining us. We hope you all remain healthy and well, and goodbye.
Thanks, everyone.